Senior Sarah Miller qualified for state girls swimming and diving meet in February. Sarah placed 22nd of 59 divers at the meet and finished 10 spots higher than last year at the meet. Sarah also holds the school record for 6 and 11 dive competitions. Congratulations to Sarah Miller. I don't believe her family's here either because of the soccer game, so we will.
If you would like to move on then to McClure South Berkeley students. At the State Career Development Conference.
If the DECA students that are here and Dr. Muhammad and Mr. Lawler can please come forward. Many parents here should stand. Seniors Josh Barnes, Ricky Wilborn, Krishan Bryant, and Kelly Garner, and sophomore Diamond Smith represented McClure South Berkeley at the DECA State Career Development Conference March 13th through the 15th at Lake Ozark, Missouri. All five students placed first or second at districts, earning them their first trip to the state meet and placed in the top 25 at the state competition. DECA is part of our district's marketing curriculum, and competitions are a way for students to demonstrate what they have learned in marketing and business related classes during the school year. Congratulations.
Thank you.
your turn again. Would you please tell us about the e-reader donations at Ferguson Middle?
Dr. Katie Chambers and Jennifer Stevens would please come forward. Project Heart, a nonprofit organization created by the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign students, presented 13 Kindle Fires and 3 Nook Colors to students at the Ferguson Youth Initiative facility on March 12. Project Heart launched in 2015 as a registered student organization at the University of Illinois. The organization focuses on collecting e-reader donations to give to children who have limited access to books. 13 of the e-readers were given directly to Ferguson Middle students chosen by teachers for their dedication to reading this year and the great progress they've made as readers. Ferguson Middle's Jennifer Stevens coordinated the effort on behalf of our students. Thank you.
We have Lotus McDonald, and she brought her Kindle with her to show.
In the Walgreens Expression Challenge. Kaylee received $2,000 for her writing regarding the stigma of mental illness. Congratulations to Kaylee.
We'll get a picture with Kaylee.
When she gets here.
Yeah.
Berkeley Middle Administrator receives Alvin M. Francis Education Leadership Award. Ms. Weichel?
Dr. James Allison, would you please come forward? Berkeley Middle School Assistant Principal Dr. James Allison has been selected for the Alvin M. Francis Educational Leadership Award from Lindenwood University. Alvin Francis was a social studies educator at Berkeley Junior High School in 1961. Selection for the recipient of this award is intentional and focused to select someone who is a first generation doctoral level graduate student from rural roots. In particular, it is duly noted that when this individual chooses to serve students in locations with high needs, be it very rural or urban, the graduate receiving this award, Dr. Allison, has consistently demonstrated leadership traits of good character, including honesty, wisdom, fairness, vision, creativity, approachability, academic competency, and administrative excellence. The Francis family established this award to honor the loving memory of Alvin M. Francis, a professional administrator who held up the belief that rank does not confer privilege or give power, but imposes an awesome responsibility on those who have been blessed with the opportunity to lead. Congratulations, Dr. Allison. South Berkeley and the state wrestlers, please come forward. to note, last month we did honor the McClure State wrestler, so this month we're picking up McClure and McClure South. McClure and McClure South Berkeley wrestlers qualified for the Misha State Championships. McClure senior Jarvis Hubbard is a two-time state qualifier and was named first team all-conference. Junior Mario Hubbard and sophomore Jalen Jenkins were named second team all-conference. McClure South Berkeley senior Lawrence Woods is a four-time state qualifier and took second place at the state championships. He was also a member of the McClure South Berkeley Misha State Track Championship team in 2015. Lawrence has accepted a football scholarship at Truman University. Congratulations to the McClure South Berkeley state qualifiers. Audience, if you would please stand as well and
come forward if you want for the picture. Parents, for the parents. Ms. Hubbard. Vacuums come on. Tighten up the grip just a little bit there. Mr. Morris, if you can step over.
The judges rated the teams on taste, originality, and plating. Students were also challenged to make a smoothie for the judges while riding the smoothie bike. The event was very competitive and the judges had a difficult decision to make. However, the McClure High School team won the competition with their stuffed spinach biscuits. And their backstage sponsor is Wendy Harris, but she was not able to be here tonight. But again, we have our winning chefs here.
Yes.
So congratulations. For a picture as well.
They were delicious from what I
understand. We always take that place to land for everybody.
Is the recipe on the board, sir?
You know what? We should put it on there. That's a great idea.
Is that the recipe?
Yeah.
All right, everybody look right here.
Of the early education opportunities offered by the district. The Ferguson-Florissant
forward and introduce to us the district support staff of the year.
Yes, ma'am. Ferguson-Florissant School District has named Tom Miller the 2016 Support Staff of the Year.
Yes, first time. Come on, Tom.
Mr. Miller starts his day early to minimize the interruption to the schools as he maintains the district phone system. Mr. Miller views his role as behind-the-scenes support of the work in classrooms. Mr. Miller is passionate about his work and the Ferguson-Florissant School District. Thank you for your hard work and dedication.
Sheila Carves up front.
Yeah.
The Ferguson-Florissant School District has named Johnson Wabash's Sheila Carves the 2016 Teacher of the Year.
Yeah.
To the students of Johnson Wabash and consistently provides excellent instruction and inspires students to achieve at high levels. Ms. Carves' students had the highest communication arts performance on the map in the district last year.
Yeah.
And we wish her well as she aims for the state Teacher of the Year.
All right.
Department, and I'm on the Wellness Committee. Last week I attended an Employee Wellness Committee meeting where we had a great discussion revolving around employee health initiatives. Several schools were represented and we discussed the need to have various school initiatives as well as district-wide initiatives. We will be meeting one more time before school is out to discuss back-to-school health assessments for our employees. Because, you know, as we stated in the meeting, happy employees in front of children, I mean, it's just, you know, there's no measure you can put on that. The Farm to School Grant has been accepting applications for our schools to request funding for a garden bed as well as field trips to local farms. We have received many grants and are excited about the opportunity for schools to grow herbs in their gardens that will be used in our school lunches. Now I know the one at Halls Ferry Is there another school that has one right now? And I don't know that that's exactly this garden, but it, if anybody gets a chance, if they still got their garden going in Halls Ferry, Lisa?
Yes, they do.
They do.
They're planting right now.
See? You know, maybe you ought to send out an email when it's harvest time, you know? That'd be kind of cool. And Kelly Bristow, she's our dietitian, and at 12:44 a.m., Benjamin Robert Bristow was born, 6 pounds, 8 ounces, and 20 inches long. He came into the world 2 weeks early. And Kelly and Ben are doing great. So that's exciting news. I want to congratulate Leslie Hogshead and Connie Harge. They won the school board election. I commend everybody who ran. And I know how difficult that is. And I was really pleased this year because it stayed, it was a nice election. That's all I'll say. I'll ramble too much about that. Now here's a question that I've been struggling with for probably 3 years, maybe 4, and I still don't have an answer to it. And my question is, the first time I saw it goes to the elections. I remember saying, who is this guy named Keith Brown? Who is that guy? You know? And I still kind of wonder about that. But
he's kind of wondering himself,
you know? My right-hand man here, you know, I'm going to really miss him. This is his last meeting other than the reorganization meeting next week. But I will say, he's a very honorable, great character, man of deep faith, who cares tremendously about this district community and our kids. He brought an element to this board that, how can I say it, what's a nice way of saying it? Your age and your wisdom. But you may not know what was it, tweeter or Twitter, yeah. I know what that is. But I'll tell you what, I know for myself, I don't know what I would have done without him all these years. And I'm surely going to miss him. But I look forward to moving on with the new board, and the contributions he's made are immeasurable. I know you see the public session, the hours behind the scenes are too many to count. I actually told my wife not to count them because I did not want to know that information. And Keith, I will miss you tremendously, and I will give you a big man hug. That's all I have.
I had hoped that next month before I left, I'd have an opportunity of making a couple of remarks. I'm still hoping that will be the case, but if I could make one remark right now that I would elaborate on next month, that I have been humbled by the people that I've been around, not only on this board, but on the cabinet and the people that I've grown to know and to deeply feel great affection towards. What a terrific bunch of people we have here. I am honored to have been with you for these 3 years in more ways than you'll ever know. And the folk on the board here, my colleagues, have just been wonderful. I don't want to go on any further about that. I'll reserve that for next month. But I have been the, and thank you for your kind remarks. I'll give you the money later. the stakeholder and community engagement report is my responsibility. And the district is reaching out to our community in numerous ways,
and building relationships through multiple initiatives designed to strengthen the district. And on March 16th, the district held its first annual State of the School event with several hundred stakeholders in attendance. And Dr. Davis presented the present state, the work to date, and plans for the future, and recognized many partners in the community who have joined with the district to benefit our students. And that was a terrific thing, and I hope that will continue, and I'm sure that it will. On April 2nd, Walnut Grove Elementary hosted its first parent university. In addition to an inspirational keynote message, parents had the opportunity to learn interviewing skills, information about homeowning, as well as other topics, including banking, if I recall, to provide the best opportunities for their children. Dr. Davis, myself, and Dr. Bland were in attendance, and I know that Dr. Davis and I afterwards spoke about it, and what a wonderful opportunity for our stakeholders and such to actually go and attend something so pragmatic as that. And I think that Dr. Davis was absolutely hit a home run when he spoke, because it really is a very touching thing for him in terms of those types of skills to be learned. And so that was terrific. And the district is hosting a screening of the documentary film Most Likely to Succeed tomorrow evening at 6:30 at McClure South Berkeley. All are invited to attend this provoking film that focuses on alternative approaches to education. And again, this is the stakeholder and community engagement report. Thank you.
Dr. Graves.
Good evening. Good evening.
I'm going to get there. All right, my portion of the strategic plan is student achievement. March 30th through April 1st, the Targeted Leadership Consulting Team returned to the district to continue their work around the cycles of professional learning. Guided visits took place at Walnut Grove, Lee Hamilton, and McClure South Berkeley. On Friday, April 1st, principals continued their instructional leadership professional development by delving deeper into their book studies. The next guided visit on powerful practices will be on April 15th at Airport and Combs. The district is partnering with the Neighborhood Houses to submit a 21st century grant application for the 2016-2017 school year to support before and after school activities for Airport, Bermuda, and Johnson Wabash. The purpose and intent of the 21st century after school grant is to provide students with opportunities that support the regular school day core academic subjects and engage students in fun, hands-on learning activities during non-school hours. And just an update, middle school summer school has changed from Berkeley Middle to Cross Keys Middle School. And one thing I did want to say was on Saturday, I had the opportunity to hear a group of talented kids that we have. We had an all-district instrumental concert where approximately 700 students from 23 of our schools joined together to perform a concert showcasing all grade levels. And if you missed it, it was fantastic. And one great thing that I noticed was that we dropped the kids off at 11 and they played all together in unison at 1 o'clock. And I just think that was amazing. So my hands goes off to our fine arts department, because it was a beautiful, beautiful performance. And I hope we continue to do that as we go further.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My portion of the strategic plan is the district's infrastructure, technologies, and facilities. In the technology side of it, they're in the process of doubling the Wi-Fi access points in multiple buildings here in the school district: Holman, Walnut Grove, Griffith, Cool Valley, Bermuda, Airport, Central, Lee Hamilton, Berkeley Middle, Ferguson Middle, Halls Ferry, Commons Lane, and Wedgewood. So for those people who have all the mobile devices, you should be able to get a good internet signal. There are also the Chromebooks that the board approved, they purchased, the district purchased, They've received them, they're all set up. They should be, I think they're distributed to the schools. Now, these are the schools that they identified that had a low ratio of mobile devices. So they'll have those in place in time for the VAP testing. And then this evening, Mr. O'Neill will be presenting the security camera system that they've put in place throughout the school district. They think they have 11 schools completed and 13 more still to go, but they're gonna give a demonstration tonight on that. This Saturday, for those that like trivia, there's the Samantha Lipka scholarship trivia in honor of Samantha Lipka, a former student at McClure, that they hold the trivia every year, and they raise money for the Ferguson-Florissant students, and they raise thousands and thousands of dollars to our graduating seniors. So if you like trivia, you don't have plans Saturday night, I believe there are still some tables available. Also on May 14th, Ferguson's having their annual Twilight Run. If you don't need a run, you just like to walk, or if you want to just stand on the sidewalk and cheer everybody on, it's a great family event, great music, and fun. So that will be on May 14th. And that's all I have. Thank you.
Ms. Hogshead?
I'm on the talent portion of the strategic plan, and thank you for your congratulations. It's good to be back. Scary, but good to be back. For the talent hiring, we are in the session of trying to hire the new positions for the next school year, as well as Dr. Davis's approved reorganization. So the HR department is very busy in that aspect, and we will be continuing getting more updates, and in May we will bring you more at that time. The HR department is also bringing forth tonight another software applicant tracking bid for us to decide on. On election day, I was at Lee Hamilton, and I just wanted to take my hat off to the Lee Hamilton teachers. It was so nice to see the parents drive up, the teachers come out to the car, they called each student by name, saying, open the door for them, saying, come on, let's go in school. I'm a touchy-feely person, and that just touched my heart to watch the kids get such a good start of, good morning, here we are. It was very exciting. So at the end of the day, I was there again, and they did the same thing. They brought them out, put them in the car, buckled them up, and let their parents take them home. So my hat, and maybe other schools are doing it, I don't know that, but my hat really goes off to Lee Hamilton and the teachers. And it didn't matter what grade the teachers taught, they knew all of the students, and it was just very warm. And so I thank you, Lee Hamilton.
Well, yes, we had the annual municipal elections on April 5th, and I'd like to congratulate Connie Hart. Where are you at, Connie? Stand up. And again, congratulations to Leslie. She worried the whole time, but we got through it. And welcome back. Welcome back. And Mr. Brown, it's going to be sad to see you gone. Very sad. You look so unhappy.
Somebody show me how I'm supposed to. Thank you, Paul.
We will miss you very much. Your insight into things and your comments have been outstanding. I really appreciate all the efforts you put into this board. You'll be missed. And tonight is my last regular meeting as president of the board, and I want to thank the board for their support over the last year. And it's been a much different year this year. I really take my hat off to Dr. Davis. He has just been a marvelous addition to the school district.
to work with him this year, and I'll miss that too. I'll be around. I'm not gone yet.
We're doing all that.
I'm not gone yet, but it'll be nice sitting down there at the other end of the table for a change. And what's that?
I said I got it warmed up for you.
You got it warmed up for me? Well, thanks. I'll be down there shortly. And presidency does take up a lot of time. You spend a lot of time on the phone with other board members and superintendents and parents. And it's been a rewarding morning year, and I really appreciate all the support I've gotten from everybody. So this coming November, however, I'm running for state representative of 68th District here in Florissant. And so I'll need your support that time too. So I need to devote more time to that, and everything will be good. All right.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
All right, Dr. Davis.
Yes, sir. I'll try to be as brief as I can. I really appreciate all of what has been said this evening. I want to start by saying to Mr. Brown that he's only four doors down from me. I mean, we live close, so I could go to him all the time, right? But I really appreciate him. When I was interviewing for this job, he and I had several conversations, and I really appreciate his leadership and more importantly, his friendship. So I just like to give you another round of applause, Mr. Brown.
I really do want to say this, and I mean this from the bottom of my heart. We've made a lot of tough decisions, as you well know, the board has. And the greatest decision that this board has made, and I'm very proud to have been part of it, was to bring Dr. Davis in.
And I'm so looking forward to continue working with Leslie. We have often have conversations, and I'm excited about, the work we'll do together as a team, because that's what it takes, is teamwork. And also happy about Ms. Harris coming on board. I had several conversations with her too, and it's really important to me to have good relationships with my board and our board, because we work as a team. It's not us and them, it's us as a team working together. And so I appreciate you, Ms. Harris, as well for your commitment to public education and the work we'll do going forward. So thank you all for that. So looking forward to it. A couple quick things, and then I have someone else I want to bring up to help me make a point on another item that I want to present. I was really excited about the parent university that Walnut Grove had the other Saturday. Mr. Brown and I attended, and it was amazing. And the reason it resonated with me was because of the workshops that they did for the parents. And one of those workshops, a couple of them, but one was on interviewing and resume writing, and then on family finance. And I think that's a huge part of this sort of systems thinking that we have to put into when it comes to supporting our families. And there was the bankers there, and I think we have to really educate our community around budgeting and financing and credit. Those are particular items and issues I think we have to talk about in our community to help our parents and to help our students really be aware of that. So I was excited about that, and I look forward to more parent universities being held as we build up our FACE department in the district. Tomorrow night, I ask you to come out, if you would, to McClure-South Berkeley High School. We will have the Most Likely to Succeed video. And that is sort of a precursor to the conversation we will have about STEM in our community. Many people have asked me about what the plans are, and so we don't have any, we have some great ideas, but what we want it to be is organic, that we want to have our community be a part of the conversation so that we build what it looks like going forward, everyone's voice is a part of that and is being heard. And the video, I think, is a good way. It's about an hour and a half, so bring your pajamas and we have popcorn and all that, so we'll have a great time. But I think what it does is it gives us an opportunity to get into the mindset of what STEM can look like in our community. So please come out tomorrow evening at McClure-South Berkeley. And it starts at
6:30
p.m. In the auditorium. So please come. And then speaking of, the State of the Schools address that we gave on March 16th, and talking about partnerships, we have a great partnership with some amazing partners in the community. And Amy Murphy is here tonight, and she's going to talk a little bit about it now. She has to leave, and so I needed to make sure she had that chance. So I want to take a point of privilege during my presentation for the strategic update, because I think this is really key. We've been partnering with the Santa Fe Center for School Transformational Leadership, Transformational School Leadership, and then Washington University's Institute for School Partnership. And we've spent a great deal of time over the last few months working together on a proposal that is being funded. And so she's going to come at this time and share with you what that looks like. So I'll give her a round of applause.
So I want to talk to the bring me in earlier. I'm with the Greater St. Louis Community Foundation, which for those
get her mic on.
I'm with the St. Louis Community Foundation.
Even closer.
Even closer.
It's not on.
It's not on.
How do I turn it on? I'm from a much smaller
there
district.
We go.
We don't need microphones. I'm the St. Louis Community Foundation, and we work with individuals, families, and businesses to help put charitable dollars to work. And so what that means is we have families and people that bring their charitable dollars to the Community Foundation, and some of them have visions about what they want to do, putting their dollars to work to improve the St. Louis area. And we had one family who came to us with this idea. They did research nationally about what best practices are, what kinds of things are working in other districts, what kinds of things can be most effective to transform districts into the most effective places they can be. And so we started working with Linda Hinkey at the Santa Fe Center, and you all may remember her as the superintendent in the Maplewood Richmond High School District when it changed from being a Bailing School District, literally about to lose accreditation, to being now just recently passed a tax levy that was passed by two-thirds of the community, because they needed to increase the number of teachers and resources that they have because of the great success in the school district. Families are, there's great things going on there. So we worked with Linda Hinkey and then with Washington University through their Institute for School Partnership. And then the next part of it was to find a school district that this work that they were hoping to do, where it would find a good home. And quite frankly, your leadership that you showed this past year in hiring Dr. Davis was the primary indicator for us that this school district is ready for this kind of work. Now, this is philanthropic dollars coming to the district. The first grant is $400,000, and it will be over $1 million over 3 years.
Yes. Yes.
Bring others besides this one family to the table to support your work as well. We are very aware that you all are doing the work and the teachers that are in the district. And I love your puzzle behind you of One District Unified, because of course this is a project to increase, to improve leadership, teacher leadership in the district. And Dr. Davis, has been a joy, and hearing you all talk has just been music to my ears. So I just want to thank you all for your willingness to work with outsiders, to work with those who are considered experts in their area, to be open to the magic that collaboration among institutions, people in the area can do. And we look forward to at least 3 years of working with the Ferguson-Florissant School District to improve things. By the way, the Community Foundation also holds the scholarship programs for the district and the foundation, and we're right in the middle of making sure that your students learn about who gets their scholarships, which is why I can't stay tonight. So
okay.
And the Community Foundation is 100% behind the district, and certainly these donors who stepped forward and wanted to work with Dr. Davis. So thank you for having us. And
So, I want to ask you to come, because I know she has to leave, and so there, so it's an item on the agenda for the board to take action on, but I wanted her to be, at least be able to give some background on the work we're trying to do in the community to bring resources here, because, yeah, I can tell you, I'm just one person, and, you know, I'm a teacher at heart, but we have some amazing teachers in our district, and this wouldn't be possible had our teachers not been embracing the work we're doing every month. And in fact, today we had an IOT session in this room with all of our schools, and you know, we have some of the most amazing people in our classrooms every day. And you know, and the reason I'm passionate about it is because my baby is one of them. And you know, and that's really important that we make sure every child gets a quality education. And I sit here because of that. And I think that as we bring partners in from the community, Santa Fe Center, Washington University, other universities that we're partnering with, it really is about focusing on the instructional core, what's going on with our children in classes, and the teachers that teach them, and the content that they're learning. So let's give our teachers a round of applause. All of our teachers. All of our teachers to stand, because I know that some of them are here. All of our teachers that are here with us this evening, please stand.
Dr. Davis, real quick, on just piggybacking on all this, could you mention a few things? Because I am getting questions about your celebrity letter.
Oh, yeah.
I guess I should have said something about that.
Yeah. I mean, Channel 2, I'm getting after your appearance.
I was trying not to go too far because I have a list of things, but I know time is of the essence. You all won't believe this. The lack of sleep I get, I guess, is because we're always trying to figure out. So really, the initiative around our $2 million campaign for reading is specifically about putting resources in the hands of our students and our teachers. Reading has been the one issue that we push really hard. You know, as Amy mentioned a minute ago about One District United, it's about bringing together all of the people in the community that we can to help support what's going on in the classroom. I believe personally that when students read daily at least an hour and they're reading within their Lexile range on books they're interested in, and they do it every day, that they have to improve. It's almost like if you start running an hour a day in a couple of months time, you're gonna be trim, because it is hard work. And reading is hard work. And there's no way in this community or any other that we will improve if our children don't engage in reading every day. And so we have to be intentional around what that looks like. When I saw students from Ferguson Middle getting their e-readers and putting them in their hands, you know, we need to have print material and digital material and everything we can put in the hands of our students. I have a lot of friends around the country, and so we have a lot of people who spoke out when the incident happened in our community around the incident with Michael Brown. A lot of stars spoke out against some of the things that they didn't agree with that happened and so forth, but said they wanted to help, and so I've just asked them for their help. And all the dollars that we would get will go to our foundation to support four things: put in classroom libraries in all of our classrooms, PD, additional PD for teachers to support IOTs and the work that we're already doing. Teachers are often, every school has a powerful practice, and they need resources to be able to have the PD that they need in particular, and the resources around that. You know, also with our parents and the community, is how do we bring our families in? We talk about parent university. How do we get our parents more involved? And it takes dollars to engage our parents, because we need our parents to be a huge part of their children's education. I often have conversations with parents who want to go back to school themselves. So how can we be a support to families to bring community together? And it takes a lot to build community. And then just resources to get all of this done is the fourth part. Additional resources that go in the classroom. Everything will be in the classroom in some way or another, or directly impacting what's happening in the classroom. And so that's why we put that out for. So I'm waiting for Oprah to call me. She didn't call me yet. But we have got some responses from some people that I won't call out yet, because I want to shore those up before I make any kind of public announcement about it. But you know, it's almost like asking for on Christmas Day, the world. And you know, if you get part of it, there's a saying that goes, if you
I reach for the moon because even if you miss, you're still amongst the stars. And so we, you know, at all costs, let's go get what our children need and transform public education for Ferguson-Florissant. I hear people, when I first started, saying that we were and we used to be, well, let's do it again.
That's right.
And I'm the leader, and I hope you'll follow me. And I'm going in the right place for my son and everybody that's a child I'm serving. So that's what that's about. And I'm happy to be here.
Before you leave, I just wanted to say that if I could get Mr. Hampton to find a couple pins to sign the, we have people sign it. You're part of our community now. I'd like you take a moment and sign that. And anybody else is here that would like to sign it tonight also, that would be great. Mr. Earl is sitting over here, and I built that puzzle. And you can fill that. There you go. There's a Sharpie.
Three.
Good
deal.
It's a lot of elementary school.
That's true.
Early childhood, yeah.
All right. Before we go any further on, I saw that Sarah Miller came. If you'd like to come up and get your award.
Sarah, did you guys win?
Well, did you win or lose? Comments. Board allocates this portion of the meeting to stakeholders the opportunity to comment both on agenda items and non-agenda items at the start of each board meeting. Prior to the public comment period, participants are asked to fill out a comment card with their name, address, phone number, and email address, and topic to be addressed, and will be allowed up to 3 minutes to speak. Members of the audience who wish to speak to the board are requested to speak from the podium, identify themselves, and in keeping with District Policies 4054, 4059, and personnel law, should refrain from making negative comments that are personally identifiable. While the board will not directly respond to the speakers during the public comment period, the board president may make clarifying remarks at the end of the comment session. Mr. Clark.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm Jim Clark. Most of you know who I am. Last month we had a new organization given to the constituents of the district and staff. And I'm wondering what progress was made on filling those positions and how soon we expect to have those identified.
I can comment on the fact that we did vote on some this evening, and that Dr. Davis is bringing more of them soon. So he is diligently working on it right now.
So thank you for that question. We actually had a conversation about it this afternoon, and we'll be putting some of the postings on tomorrow that have been approved. We have some resumes and trying to get pictures and all so that we can have community and all stakeholders see who the team is or part of the team that has been brought on board. So we'll get those as early as tomorrow. You'll start seeing some of it, and then we'll get them up as soon as possible.
At this time, the board will take a recess to congratulate the recipients of the award tonight. It is 8:02. Let's meet back at 8:15.
Teacher and non-teacher, $8,205,687.98. Operational disbursements, $2,827,381.07. Total, $11,033,69.05.
Need a motion to accept the consent agenda.
I move that we accept the consent agenda.
Second.
And moved by Mr. Spoh, seconded by Mr. Ebert. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Now what we've been waiting for. Been promised for months on end to see the security camera demonstration.
Good evening, Paul. What's good as you expected? Due to our successful bond issue last year, the school district has begun implementing the first phase of our safety and security bond project. The installation of a district-wide surveillance camera system has begun. The first step of that was to install the camera system in 24 locations, including our elementary schools, our middle schools, the Challenger Learning Center, transportation, and the Ferguson Middle Annex. The next round of camera will be our high schools and the administration center. With this project, we are more than doubling the number of cameras and improving the picture and recording quality of our camera and recording system. We'll have a total of cameras district-wide of 1,670 cameras throughout our district. Our board member, Mr. Chabot, has been updating you at every one of the meetings with our progress on the monthly meetings as part of his strategic plan report. This is just a continuation of his updates, and we will present a demonstration of the new camera system tonight from Amoresco. At this point, 11 are operational, and the others, they've all been adjusted, aimed and focused and operating well. The others have been installed, and we're just doing the final adjustments to get them online as well. I did want to mention that this has been a team effort of our staff. We talk about team a lot, and this was a team effort. Facilities working with IT and security and Amoresco has made this project to the point that it's at and be a successful project. Tonight, the team at MRS will be performing the demonstration of the new camera system for you, and I hope that you enjoy it. We have some really good cameras and good pictures. Two of the members will be actually doing the presentation, Scott Fowler, who is the Director of Operations for Amoresco, and Daniel Shea, who is the Project Development Engineer of Amoresco as well.
Good evening, I'm Scott Fowler. I'm the Director of Operations for Amoresco. This is Daniel Shea, one second. Eric Fraley, sitting to your right, is our Vice President. Dan Gerard Clay is the Senior Account Rep for Ferguson-Florissant. As you can see on your screen, this is a, as you can see on the screen, we've got Parker Road Elementary School pulled up. Just wanted to point out a minor thing on here. This is a floor plan of the school, and you can see the blinking red lights on there. Those are cameras that are showing movement, and it could be anything from one of the custodians playing after hours to possibly an intruder, which is part of the point of the camera system itself. So if you would click on one of the cameras to get an idea, it shows the actual camera view itself, and then you can click again in a large A camera, you can actually take a look and see the clarity of the camera system itself. Yeah, we have very good resolution with these cameras. Let's go ahead, let's pull up some history from Parker Road itself, and we'll show you some views of the hallway when school is in session. Several examples here. These are recent history, 2 days ago, I believe, is what the file data is on these cameras. We're actually reading from the hard drives on the servers themselves. As we're waiting for the system to load you. Here, let's see your place. Just great clarity. This is between classes, midday, and you can pause, and you can actually zoom in on a couple of the kids here and see the clarity that we've got on camera so they can play and be able to see them. Even though, you know, we can still zoom in and what's going on in the school. Then the next one that we'd like to show is some of the kids coming in from recess at the same school itself. This is an exterior view. The kids coming in off the playground, lining up, going in the side door. And this isn't necessarily an optimum view because we've got, you can see the shading from the tree in the background. So we don't have a great deal of light on the kids' faces, but you can still get really good resolution on the kids themselves and actually see what's going on. So it could be anything from the kids, maybe somebody falls, has an accident, you're able to show the parents exactly. Or, you know, possibly even an intruder. To the building itself. And then the next one that I think I want to show is some night footage here. And we had Daniel run out last night broke into the office. Now, keep in mind, this is a completely dark school. No lights on whatsoever, so it's pitch black. Now, we do have some motion effects here, but when he stops, you can see the clarity. It's pitch black in the room here. There's no lights whatsoever. Now he turns the lights on. That's the infrared getting used to itself. And it switches back to color. And then, do you come back in the room here?
I walk back.
Walk back. Take a look at the color of his shirt here. It's a dark shirt. And in the infrared footage, you can actually see, you know, how it lightened him up in there. So you've got great coverage. And this, all these cameras are fitted with infrared modules on them, so that we have the ability to see in a darkened space itself.
You can blow that up also, right? When
absolutely.
In the infrared, the dark.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. All I have
you lose some of the resolution.
Yeah, can you do that?
Yeah,
sure.
It's right.
Can you see the bottom? Yeah. I'd like to see what that. Oh, wow.
Flat.
Wow.
Yeah.
Thanks for that.
Hopefully I'm there.
Right.
Yeah, they've got your photo now. Mm-hmm. Okay, we're going to switch over to homeschool. Or are we going to homes to show some lunchroom recordings? Yeah, we've got to log in here, so it'll take us just a second to get logged in. We've got some footage that's bookmarked. That was actually a live photo over there.
Wow.
And this is full motion video. It's all 1080p, high definition, 30 frames per second. It's extremely easy to stop, take a snapshot of the any picture that you want. You can zoom in on any area of the screen and see what's happening. In particular, we were actually reading a karate book the other day. One of the kids handed out on the, you know, you see all the karate poses that he had. It was actually really cool. And then, I'd like to go to the exterior of homes also, just to give you an idea. These are all the parents that are lined up, coming to pick up the kids at the end of the school day. I just want to demonstrate the resolution of the camera. We're going to zoom in the car right behind the red Ford Explorer coming forward. We're going to pause this right there, and we're going to zoom in on that license plate. You're going to be able to read it. And that's roughly about a 100-foot shot that we're doing with the cameras. And you can actually make out that the license plate. It's a DG2B2J on there. The screen's a little stretched, but when you zoom in, you can actually get some really great resolution out of these cameras. Around the exterior and the interior of the camera.
Oh, yeah.
The school itself.
Wow.
Along?
No idea.
Along with the system that we have on the computer, we actually have got the ability for you to load the system on an iPad or an Android device, tablet or a phone, either one. And you can take, and you can see this is a night view over at Combs Elementary. We've got actually pretty good resolution going on here. This will get loaded on all the security folks here at the district. Police and fire at the same time. One additional feature that the system allows is, besides just being able to put it on your phone, we can turn the phone into a body camera, and it automatically records directly to the DVR itself and picks up the audio. So if there's an incident, security staff can turn it on where it is a lanyard and then go respond to whatever that happens to be happening. In a school, so you've got full recording capability of any incident that happens within the schools. These will be, this particular system will get installed at the middle schools and the high schools, both. So, I know Tom Dunlop, the security director, is extremely pleased with that ability in the system itself. We've actually had several incidents that we've been able to pull and get resolved. So it's been a great help. And that, I believe, takes us through. We've got roughly about six schools left that need to be aimed and focused. We're on target for being complete by June, having everything programmed complete with the school maps themselves. And that, I believe, takes us to the end. Do you guys have any questions for us?
Yeah, you have pretty good depth of field here. Is there any position where the lens is not sharp?
Generally speaking, when you get out much past about 100 feet on these high-resolution cameras, it gets a little tough. It gets pixelized.
It seemed to me that you lost a bit of detail when you were real close. Am I right on that?
Actually, no. It's high detail when you're close.
It was just in the layout.
Yeah. You actually want to go to... Is this showing up on your laptops also?
No.
This is the lunchroom. It's for one of the hallways. We've actually got even better detail on her dress.
I was watching the movement of some of the kids that were running by, that's all. I just thought when it got real close. But how long is the data? Do you keep the data?
We keep 30 days, and then it records over the top of itself.
And you can put it on a thumb drive or anything that you
absolutely
want to save.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
you can. You feel the need to save, you can keep the actual movie file on your computer indefinitely.
Yes.
There's also a feature where you can take a picture that you have of somebody in a vehicle and take a snapshot, and it goes right to your desktop and saves it there.
Mm-hmm. So Terry, are we going to keep it for 30 days, or are we trying to do longer?
We're trying to do longer. We're using the memory that we have is what
Well, it really depends by school. The camera counts really define how many hard drives you have to have in the servers themselves. These are no longer the old DVRs that were
right.
Extremely expensive. These are hard drives that they get put in, and they're actually Dell servers, Blade servers that Rich uses within the district. We match the machines that he's using currently. And we're using 6 terabyte drives in them. Some of the schools, the fewest number of drives that we have are 4 in there. And some of the middle schools, I want to say we've got 24 to 30 hard drives, 6 terabyte hard drives in there. So we've got a lot of storage capacity.
So when you're storing, you've got a storage bank.
Mm-hmm.
And at some point in time, can that data get lost through, or is there a backup?
Oh, there is a backup. These servers are all rated, so we have redundancy through the machines themselves.
So if something happened, it's saved elsewhere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is a traditional, it's a Windows operating system, and works just like the rest of the servers. Oh, those are the Western Digital. Yeah, we're using Western Digital purple hard drives, which are dedicated security and surveillance hard drives in there too. They're meant to operate 24/7, 365, just continuously run. Unlike the hard drives in these machines, which are probably what they would consider the Western Digital Greens, which are residential or home use hard drives. So these are industrial drives that are in the machines themselves.
They have a security mind.
Mm-hmm.
Could you pull up that shot with where all the cameras are located, the background with the schools? Pick another one besides.
There are 3 schools, I believe, that have that set up. Let's see if
we can. Any school?
That's going to change. It'll change, yeah. We're in the process of letting
that out. All right. So what now?
Our current focus has been aiming and focusing the cameras so they're looking at the right things.
Right.
This is one of them that's kind of a work in progress. You can see
those backgrounds that you're using there, In the summer of 2000, eight of my students drew every school in the building in the district. 2.3 million square feet that we drew. Eight kids did it in 8 weeks. And the field measured every school and drew them in AutoCAD.
That's a great project, boy.
It was. It was a really fun project. So it's good to see that 16 years later, it's still working. Yeah. Yep. Still able to use them.
Yeah, we are.
Is it possible that we will ever be able to get them in the actual classrooms instead of just the hallway? Is that something that we're ever thinking about?
We're not allowed to do.
We're not allowed. Okay.
We're not allowed to videotape classrooms.
Okay.
So it was questionable about even the cafeterias and gyms, but
really?
The place they said we're going to be
okay. But no classrooms.
At this time, I don't know if that changes. We could do it.
Okay.
So if you wanted something 20 days, happened 20 days ago, how quick can you get there?
If you have the software installed on your computer, it's pretty much instantaneous. I mean, you'll be working basically like I am right now. You'll have a drop-down list of all the schools. You pick the school that you need to send that, and then
So basically, you pull it down, pick the camera you want, drop the data that you want, and watch it go.
So, who's going to have access to this?
Principals and their selected staff.
Okay.
Security, obviously, all the security.
So, could this also be used in a positive vein, like you have an assembly and you forgot to, I don't know, get a picture of somebody who was awarded? I mean, could a principal just? Well, it's kind of cool. Well, I'm just saying.
It's a good thought.
You know.
The bad.
Well, you know.
So we're back to this is March 16th.
We've got March 16th. We're back a month.
Oh wow.
There.
A windy day.
Mm-hmm. How is it in the weather? Is there any difference in like rain or the
quality stays the same? It'll pick up the motion of like rain. Or in this case, there's.
If you look at the bottom of the screen too, you can see there's green, see those green lines? There's gray and green. The green means there's activity.
Activity.
And sometimes you'll watch something, I've been playing with it almost every day at work in the evening, and you'll see these green lines, and sometimes it's the flag waving, it's the rain, it's wind, it's leaves blowing across.
The other thing that we did when we set up, I apologize, the other thing that we did when we set the system up, we've got the ability to record one frame per second on this. So just in case there happens to be an incident, you at least get one frame of motion. You know, if something just flies by really quick and the motion sensors within the cameras don't pick that up, don't recognize it because it was too fast, we're at least getting one frame per second from every camera within the district. So we're able to pick up, you know, some oddity.
I think one thing we didn't mention, kind of explain that too, is that what happens is we're not constantly recording that. We're just saving our memory and storage so it's, we can store longer. And so when there's motion, it kicks on.
Okay.
And he's saying he gets a frame even before it kicks on, one frame back.
Yeah.
Life expectancy?
I'm sorry?
What's the life expectancy?
Well, you know, honestly, these cameras are pretty doggone reliable. Our warranty is 5 years on the cameras themselves. I think the Dell servers are 3. And I want to say the hard drives are 3 years also, either 1 or 3, but out of bed, these cameras will be operating for, they're pretty bulletproof, they're solid state. I bet they go for 10 to 15 years, maybe 20. You know, at that point, you know, it'll be new technology time. I think the, quite honestly, I think the servers and hard drives will wear out before that. You know, we'll probably have one of these blade servers. We built them pretty stiff. Probably get 8 years out of them, 10 years, something like that.
Another nice thing about the camera system is that our staff, Ron Johnson, as a matter of fact, in the back, is learning with Amoresco and their contractors how to install these cameras. So in the future, when they're not under warranty and we want to replace them, our staff will do it. So we're not calling somebody else in, paying them. And we can get the cameras easily and quickly. They're readily available. So it's a really good system for us to be able to take it over.
Yes.
And do it ourselves and save some money without having to have a company come in and always.
And you guys are local?
Yes, we are.
Okay.
Yeah, we've been in the St. Louis area since 1998. 98 for him, 99 for me. So, but yeah, that was one of the main features that we presented to Terry and his staff was that they would be able to maintain this. No longer do you have to go out to, like God loving an alarm, 24, and pay a yearly fee, and then, you know, big markups for buying cameras and DVRs and all that kind of stuff. You can do it all in-house.
I'm noticing something. The definition in the shadow area, you lose simply because of
yes,
the
contrast.
The contrast. Mm-hmm. But let's just say there is some incident in that darker area. Are you able to
manipulate
that darker area so that you can actually see it?
Save that as a JPEG and then take it lightning
and
use it.
Okay,
Photoshop,
so you can detail,
sharpen the image.
It's kind of like a snapshot. Somebody take a snapshot of that one frame, put it on your laptop or your desktop, and
manipulate it, sharpen it, just like, you know, any law enforcement agencies do.
Very nice.
Anybody have any more questions for him? Well, it's good to see it up and working, and it's nice, beautiful, clear pictures. I hope it's helped everybody in the district that will come in handy.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Item 18, Black History and Women's History Month's annual report, Mr. Forbes.
Good evening, Board of Education, Mr. President, Dr. Davis, and Ms. Real. Each year, at the Board's request, I get the pleasure of reporting to you all the good things that take place surrounding Black History and Women's History Month in February, March. It's a pleasure because of the great scope and variety of events that take place surrounding these important topics. Hundreds of lessons are taught, as well as a variety of announcements, assemblies, and community outreach events. Dr. Davis did his part to celebrate with students by speaking at a number of school assemblies. Eight different schools and over 800 students attended free field trips to the old courthouse provided by the National Park Service during February and March. And our students also participated in multiple essay contests, including a new contest emphasizing women's history at several schools. I've submitted a report by elementary and secondary school submissions in order for you to see some of the variety of events for Black History and Women's History Month. And these are only partial listings. Do you have any questions?
Hearing none, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks for doing this.
Thank you.
ELA Units of Study, Dr. Ward. Let's go.
Good evening, Board.
Good evening.
Davis. Over the last 4 years, the ELA, meaning English Language Arts Department, curriculum writers with the help of coordinators and content leaders, have written the ELA Units of Study. And we would like to bring the ELA Units of Study before you tonight to ask for approval for use as our district-wide ELA curriculum.
The first year of professional development for creating the new ELA curriculum was 2011-2012, and it started with designating priority standards for each grade level. These standards were designated by grade level teachers with support from an SSD teacher, a teacher in a grade below, and a teacher in the grade above.
The second year, 2012-2013, we wrote common formative assessments, and they were created for each grade level.
The third year was when the bulk of the curriculum was written using a rigorous curriculum design by Lead and Learn, which used a backwards design approach to writing curriculum, which means first you unwrap the standards to determine the unit's essential questions and then work backwards from the unit's assessments that were created the year before to create the learning objectives and instructional focus for each unit.
Year four, 2014-2015, was our pilot year, and our K-2 teachers were given an opportunity to pilot using the units that had been written.
The ELA units of study in K through 8 are divided into a reading focus and a writing focus, and each unit lasts around 4 to 5 weeks. In grades 9 through 12, the units of study are divided also into a reading focus and a writing focus for each quarter.
This is an example of what a first grade unit looks like. There are 8 units with topics ranging from tackling trouble to reading across genre to learn more about a topic. And this is an example of reading. Our next slide is an example of our writing units, narrative writing, informative writing, opinion writing, and again another unit of writing, narrative writing.
This slide is an example of the focus for each quarter for the grade 10 curriculum. In quarter one, the writing focus is argumentative writing centering around character analysis, and the reading focus is the American novel from 1800 to 1950. In quarter two, the writing focus is informative writing from a social issue derived from the text, and the reading focus is American drama from 1800 to 1950. Quarter three, the writing focus is argumentative writing on controversial issues, and the reading focus is the American novel from 1950 to the present. And then in the last quarter, the writing focus is the research paper, and the reading focus is drama from 1950 to the present.
There are two ways to access the curriculum website, and one is through the Weebly website that's listed here, and the second is through our Google Drive for ELA Missouri Learning Standards Curriculum.
For our next steps, we are going to be realigning the curriculum with the new Missouri Learning Standards that are very shortly going to be adopted by the state, we assume. This should be a relatively smooth process because for the ELA standards, they are pretty similar to the Common Core standards that we used to develop the curriculum in the first place. We're going to need to revise the units of study for grades K through 6 to better align them with the recent reading program adoption. We are going to redesignate the priority standards for each grade level in the high school due to the EOC ELA exam being moved to the end of 10th grade, so we need to make sure that we are covering all of the tested standards by the end of 10th grade. And we're going to be looking at revising curriculum for high school reading strategies classes and investigate alternative reading intervention programs at the high school level.
We'd like to especially thank our teachers for all the hard work in writing the units of standards, units of study.
Thank you. Sorry. I need a motion to accept the ELA units of study.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Ms. Hogshead and seconded by Mr. Brown. Any discussion? Any questions?
I just have one question. I'm sorry.
Sure.
Will parents be able to access the curriculum? I saw that there was a link. So is that going to be on our website and parents can go to the site if they choose to look at the curriculum?
You can actually go to the website from outside the district. Yes.
Okay.
Any further questions? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Online recruiting, applicant tracking, talent assessment, hiring, onboard, and form system human resource software. That's a mouthful. Is it expensive? Is it sound?
A little bit. It'd be more expensive than the person. Is this on?
Get closer.
Is it on?
Yes.
Okay. This evening, we've come to you to ask for approval to purchase a new software system for human resources. As you remember, last time we were here, we asked you to approve a new substitute management system, and that system is already in the process of being developed for us, and will be online July 1st. That system is also was about $1,600 less than what our current system is. This evening, the program they're going to ask me to approve is actually going to be more expensive than what we currently have, but a significant upgrade. We went through a request for proposal process. We had 8 responses for new software. Of those 8 responses, we brought 4 in for face-to-face or webinar sessions. We can take a look at their software. From those 8 down to 4, we then selected 2 as possible matches for our district. One was People Admin, Talent Ed, and the second one was Teacher Match. We strongly felt, as a reviewing committee, that People Administration, Talent Ed was the strongest of the applicant tracking programs, but it had one session, one piece of it that they did not provide, and that was the talent screening. And the talent screening is probably the most important piece that you have in helping to select great candidates. There is a program out there called Teacher Match, which we felt was the strongest in that area. We asked the companies would they be willing to work together, and they said we already do. We have several school districts where we actually integrate Teacher Match into Talent Ed. So we actually went out and applied at a couple of the districts across the nation where this is in place already, and it was seamless. The program that Talent Ed provides is so much more user-friendly than what we currently have. I've been here for a little bit over a year, and during that time, I cannot tell you the number of times, easily 40 or 50, that people have made comments to me about their inability to get onto our program and to apply to our district, that they got kicked off from the program, or when they got into the program and wanted to download some of their materials, their resume, letters of recommendation, they weren't able to do that. Or when they applied to our system, after they had applied, they were listed as being unqualified by the system because they had not precisely used the same language as what DESE does for certification. Our current program actually is a hindrance to us as a district. It keeps us from getting qualified applicants. And so we're asking to replace that program with something that's going to be much more robust, but also much more user-friendly. The new program that we're asking for, this People Administration Talent Ed, is being used by other districts in our area also. This program also has the feature where if you've applied at another district and you want to apply to Ferguson-Florissant, you can do so with one button. You can transfer all of your information over from another district to our district. So the excuses for people in the past have said, it takes so long to fill out an application for your district. And I know that's true because 2 years ago I applied to this district and that application took me almost 4 hours. They can do it with one button. They want to transfer their information from there to here and it will automatically populate our applications. So we're trying to remove some of those barriers that are out there right now and provide something that's going to be much more friendly, not only for applicants being able to apply, but also for principals to use. There is an increased cost for this. The first year, you always have a startup cost. The first year, there would be an increase of about $18,929. The ongoing after that first year would be an increase of $12,420. I would ask you to take into consideration that as an investment. And that helps you to hire better people, better teachers to put in classrooms. If it helps us to find better administrators to put in as leaders in our buildings, then that would be hopefully a good investment for us as a district tonight. I can tell you that the Teacher Match program I've been highly impressed with. We did go ahead and take a look. We did go ahead and actually apply through a couple of processes at other school districts, not going anywhere. But we did apply to see how it operated. And now, not only takes a look at the typical things about relationships, which all school districts try to look at, but it also takes a look at pedagogy. It takes a look at the teaching ability of the person. Do they understand curriculum? Do they understand instructional strategies? Can they apply that? It also takes a look at some things that are a little bit different. For instance, their grades in college. And you might think, well, everybody takes a look at their resume. Most people will take a look at their total GPA. Total GPA does not have an impact upon whether a person is successful in the classroom or not. Their last 2 years of college, yes, it does. Because in your last 2 years, what are you taking? You're teaching methodology classes. And so if you're successful in your last 2 years, you have a higher likelihood of being successful as a teacher, first year teacher. So teacher match has gone through and taken a look at those things that truly successful teachers do differently than a regular classroom or a poor classroom teacher might. And if they think that they can identify it, and from what I've seen of them, I think that they can too. So this evening, we're asking you to approve two different programs which would work seamlessly together. At the end of this summer, we'd actually be dropping the program that we're currently using, and that would be school streams. And we'd also be dropping them for forms management, so that would go by the wayside too, because forms is a part of this new talent ed. A much more friendly program, and one I think would do very well for the senior and teacher. Mm-hmm. Are there any questions?
I move we approve.
Second.
And moved by Ms. Hogshead, second by Mr. Brown.
Courtney.
Okay. Dr. Gage. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Anthony's up.
Thank you.
Equal Opportunity Schools.
Good evening. Ferguson-Florissant School District has been accepted to the Lead Hire Initiative for the 2016-17 school year, joining 117 other schools across 23 states in the cohort. As a member of the first Lead Hire cohort, Ferguson-Florissant will receive match-funded technical assistance from Equal Opportunity Schools to close its participation and success gaps in AP courses by the fall of 2017. Through a year-long partnership, EOS will support schools by providing field-leading data analysis to measure student and school-specific causes of participation gaps, develop a comprehensive strategy for addressing those causes, and by the fall of 2017, transition all of the historically underrepresented students who have been identified as being overlooked for AP into one of these course opportunities. The one-time cost for this one-year program is $75,000, $25,000 per building, for all three high schools from the 2016-17 district funds. And I'd like to mention that this program that we have an opportunity to participate in directly connects to Priority 4, the transition team report, the specific action, short-term action of determine what, if any, barriers exist for African-American students or any other underrepresented subgroups of students to enroll in advanced placement classes, and develop and implement strategies to reduce or eliminate these barriers. And this, by being a part of this cohort, it gives a process for the schools to do just that. The principals are very excited about this opportunity. I sent you several documents in the packet. There's an article about finding America's missing AP and IB students. There's a sample of the Equity Pathways report that is put together through the survey that's completed by teachers and students. And then there's a strategist that works with the schools to analyze that data, then to determine the strategies that the school would use to identify the students and figure out those causes. And then for each student, they get a student insight card, and that's where it helps you identify kids that have the growth mindset, the grit, and these strategies to be able to be successful in AP classes. And so they're really excited about this opportunity to be able to support their students accordingly.
I move we approve.
Second.
And moved by Mrs. Hogshead, seconded by Dr. Gripps. Any questions?
So, Ed, at what point will you be able to present to the board the standards that they would put in place? Because reading through the documentation, one of the recommendations they made was don't have a grade as a prereq to be accepted in AP. Now, I remember two, 3 years ago, I was getting feedback from students in AP, and some of the criticism was that they're in these AP classes, but the teachers are teaching below level, which would have been prereq, because some of the students that were in the coursework weren't prepared for it. So they felt they lost out and they just wasted an entire semester. So if you don't set a prereq grade, I'd be curious to see how that's going to work. Because I think the question was, what was the GPA for AP students? And it came back, I believe it was 2.75. It was below 3.0, and I was quite shocked for an AP class. And the reason they said, well, it's a hard class. I said, all right, fine. So that means you have some that are up there on the high level, but then you have a bunch that are way below clunky, and they're continuing in the class. So is that part of the standards, the report that you'll present to us?
Well, the College Board actually, so that there were several things that were also addressed in the transition team report centered around AP, and one of them was our prereqs, and they actually said that some of our prereqs for kids to get into AP classes were more stringent than what the College Board recommends, and so that's another way that you open up access. And so we have made some of those adjustments in our college and career planning guide to not be as restrictive, so that a student might have access. So, but we want to certainly make sure that the course is being taught at the level of rigor that it should be, and so we're doing a variety of components to address that, and that's, we are, one of the, I just submitted a PD proposal, and I just found out from Kevin Vogel that it has been, you know, approved that we can go ahead in the planning stage, and so we are going to be participating in pre-AP strategies training, so vertical teaming for pre-AP. So what we want to make sure is that our kids that take advanced and honors classes prior to going into AP classes, that the level of rigor is in those classes to support AP. So we'll be inviting teachers this summer. We just started working on the dates with the College Board, inviting teachers that teach in the core areas and world language in honors or advanced in 9th, 10th, 11th grade to be able to be in those pre-AP vertical teaming PD as an opportunity to be able to shore up the classes so that kids are prepared when they take the AP classes. And we have teachers that are being trained this summer in the AP Summer Institutes to again ensure that they have the PD that supports what needs to be happening in the AP classes, because we want the rigor to be there and to be able to support the culminating component of the AP course, which is the AP exam.
Let me add, though, one of the other things that's in the report that was surprising to me was we had almost 300 students taking AP classes, but only 16 of those students were tested. And so we didn't have any measurable data to show us whether or not any of the students, whether they had a 4.5 GPA or a 2.5 GPA, were really gaining out of this work, because there was no metric in place to see whether or not they got it, right? So I totally hear what you're saying around students get into class and the class not being watered down. Rigor is absolutely important. But what has gone on across the country is that we have students, and it's largely African-American students and Latino students of color, who are underrepresented in, you know, advanced classes. But here's the thing. You have students, and the report actually does this, and this is one of the things I really like about EOS, is that it gives a student insight card. Because there are a lot of factors, other than just grades, that can help us determine whether or not a student has the aptitude to do well in these classes. We don't want students to get in classes and fail. But one in particular, this young girl here, I'm just looking at her card, and she says this, the access barriers to AP. Not sure how to get signed up. No staff encouragement to take AP. Parents didn't attend college. You know, some students don't even know about AP classes and have the ability to, because if you look historically at some of their scores and other metrics, then they may have the propensity to do well in AP classes. And so the aim is to go after identifying all students, but in particular students of color, so that we can get more students in AP classes, taking rigorous courses and testing them to see if they're being successful. Because for me, I want teachers to teach at a deep level, because I want my son to take AP, but I want him to be able to do well. Let me say it this way. You know, we had this conversation in IOT 2 weeks ago. And students have an A's on their grades, but when they take, CFA that we create, or a benchmark that we create, or the math, they don't do well. And I see that too often. The students are making straight A's in classes, but can't pass the state exam. And that's a problem. And so what we want is the rigor to be deep, so that all students who are in these classes, first they got to know that you got to work hard. I mean, we can't sugarcoat it, you know, to say you're an AP.
you got to get in here, you got to work. But we got to go after students who, this girl here is first generation college. You know, nobody's taking the time to sit her down and say, you have the ability because of these other metrics that we've taken a look at. I'm a prime example. I never took an AP class in high school because nobody ever sat me down to tell me about AP. I didn't know about AP because I was a teacher. That make any sense to me, you know? I had the ability, so, but that happens too often to so many kids, not just black kids, white kids too. It happens to a lot of kids. And so what we have to do is be intentional around identifying students, letting them know the reality. You gotta work. Because what we don't have in our district is IB. When I was a high school principal, my high school was a full IB diploma high school. And some of the work that the students were doing in those classes was, and the writing, was the writing I didn't do until I got to graduate school in my master's program, you know? And so students already have access to that early, but we have to be, and what this does is it helps us to be intentional around looking for students who probably wouldn't go in there otherwise so that we can begin to close this gap, because that's a huge gap. And this is all about equity as well. Now, if they get in and don't work hard or whatever the case might be, that's another whole issue. But what we want to do is identify the students who have the ability and then have the conversations with them, counselors especially. I think counselors are a critical part of this. Counselors have to be able to have the conversations with students about what these metrics look like. And then we have to report out so you all can see, you know, what's going on with these dollars we're spending. I mean, Desi even gives us some support.
Right. Now, so you may mention that. We don't have our official letter yet, but what we've been, the Chris Belcher is our point of contact. He's superintendent and resident of Equal Opportunity Schools. And actually, he was a superintendent in Columbia Public Schools in Columbia, Missouri. And he, as a superintendent, his district participated in this Equal Opportunity Schools program. And they increased their AP enrollment by 20%. And over time, their scores didn't go down. So he's someone who's lived it and saw the benefits of the program to his students. And so he is a retired superintendent now, and he is the superintendent in residence of Equal Opportunity Schools. And so he's been working with DESE. There are the four Parkway schools and here in St. Louis County are also going to be part of it. And so because of this kind of cohort that's happening in St. Louis, he's reached out to DESE, you know, with, to say, hey, what support can you provide? And so I just emailed him today to find out what the status was. And they're finalizing one more school, possibly the Lee Summit. And so we will find out probably next week. DESE is going to offer a sub grant that will either, that they will cover the cost between $9,500 and $10,000 per school. So that'll take the $25,000 per school and reduce that by either $9,500 or $10,000 per school. So I'll be getting that official letter next week, and that will, you know, involve a little bit of some meetings with the other St. Louis area schools or Missouri schools that are participating, and then presenting at some point to the Missouri Board of Education as well about the work that we're doing with Equal Opportunity Schools. So that's certainly another plus that we're going to have a little bit of financial support from DESE for this program.
I just wanted to say one thing. I actually attended when we was at the MSBA conference this past year. I actually attended his class, the guy you were talking about.
Ms. Belcher?
Yep, I attended it, and I'm really excited that we're bringing this to it. And I don't know if you guys remember, but that's the one that me, you, and Scott were in. And we're in the big room. So I'm very excited about this, and I really like the whole insight cards, because not only that, it gives the teacher the opportunity to recommend a child, and it might not be, it's somebody that they're connected to, and it gives them another advocate to encourage them. And I think that's one of the biggest things, is that we don't have some of the students don't have anyone in their corner pushing them to take AP classes. So just with the whole student insight card, it really gives them the opportunity. I mean, it gives us the information that will help them grow.
Exactly, and once this year is done, we have the option for a smaller fee to continue to use their student survey, so we can continue to generate the student insight cards,
right,
on our incoming new students or incoming freshman class as well, which is another great opportunity.
So what this does is helps us with identification, but to Rob's point, it's about rigor in that class. And we have to test students so that we know whether or not they're being successful. And we haven't done that. And AP test is $92. That should be a barrier for a child taking an AP test, right? Because one is that, you know, they need to be held to the standard, and then we need to know whether or not we're delivering, that we're giving them the kind of rigor and understanding they need to be able to do well. So they get college credit for these classes if they make a 3 or higher, I think it is.
So I've included in my secondary ed budget that I've submitted to Laura for this 16-17 school year is a budget item that would include to cover the cost of the AP exams for all of our AP students for next year. I've been collecting student enrollment information for our AP classes from all three high schools so I can get an idea of what it would cost. It's $92, like Dr. Davis said. If a student would qualify for our old system of free and reduced lunch, then there's it's $52, $53. So we'll certainly work through the process that we have to determine whether or not the student would qualify for the lesser cost. And so I'm including that budget in there because we put together about 11-page, 12-page AP and dual credit handbook, and that was another recommendation in the transition team report to just really pull that out of the college and career planning guide to go in deep so parents and students really understand what AP is and what dual credit. We added dual credit in that as well since we have a plethora of dual credit classes, and so the schools are using that as a tool to be able to communicate with students and parents, and we're also going to be sharing that. We want our 8th grade and our 7th grade students to get hold of that and our parents so that they know then what those opportunities are that exist in high school. And so, but the expectation is that if you're in an AP class next year, all those students will be expected to take as a culminating activity the AP exam that occurs the first 2 weeks of May. And we'll cover that cost and hopefully also have some outside funding to help offset that. That's something else we're working on. Haven't secured yet, but we're working on it.
So, Dr. Davis, in your example of the young lady and your example, you know, I just had a thought. You wonder where, and it's probably different for everybody, but where that sense of hopelessness comes, or I can't do it. You know, is it 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th? I mean, you know, the point is kind of nip it in the bud early, and then this process would go a lot smoother.
Yeah.
You know, you just wonder where that is.
I think it starts early.
I do too. That's
my thought. And I think, I know that a lot of it comes from lack of reading skills.
Right.
And when students' reading skills are low, and it happens, the gap, I can promise you, and I shouldn't say that, but I think the gap, the achievement gap, is attributable to the reading gap in students who aren't performing well, right?
Right.
And I think if we can begin to close that gap by pushing literacy in ELA and reading, that we'll see these gaps close. And I think when, you know, and every teacher who can tell you this, success is the best motivator.
Right.
And when students see success in their, you know, academic prowess, they do better, right?
Right.
But if they never experience that, then, you know, I mean, they get, that hopelessness starts to set in. And we gotta acknowledge it and say it out loud.
Right.
And early on, I mean, my son's a 5th grader. And, you know, but we've been pushing this for a long time. Every child doesn't have that, you know, encouragement at home. So do we just leave them out? No. Right? Because I didn't have somebody like that at home when I was growing up. But I, you know, I had good people in school. So I think we have some responsibility there, I guess is what I'm saying.
Good.
And we can't keep failing our kids. Because we are. It's just
that good. Any further questions? Hearing none, all those in favor of accepting the Equal Opportunity Schools, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Bullidge, A Plus School Report.
Good evening, board.
Good evening.
Good evening, audience. How we doing? Okay, the A Plus School Report. So, every year I come before you all and talk about the A Plus program. This year I thought we'd just go over some of the basics, because there are some people that aren't familiar with this, even though they've worked in the district a number of years, because I have people come up and talk, asking all the time, what are the requirements? So when a senior graduates, they have to have a 2.5 non-weighted GPA. They have to tutor for at least 50 hours. Now we'll take care of that their senior year. Some do a little tutor in the summer between their junior and senior year, and occasionally a junior, but for the most part, they'll get their 50 hours in their senior year. They tutor in the school, and if they start the first day of school, by Christmas they'll have 65 hours. In the spring, it's a little depending on snow days. They should get about 58 to 62 hours. So they have to have 95% attendance over the 4 years. That means depending on our school schedule, they can miss 35 to 37 days in those 4 years. Has to be a good school citizen. They can't be in the office more than 10 times over the 4 years. They can't have any type ones. And they have to be advanced proficient in algebra one. That's pretty cut and dry with that. If they do that, they get free tuition to any community college in the state of Missouri. Now, a lot of people say, well, no, they can go to Truman State. No, they can go to Truman State, and Truman State has a scholarship, but it's not going to pay the tuition. Here, it pays the tuition for 2 year community colleges. And when this was started in 1993, it was to elevate the technical skill of the residents of the state. That was the initial intent. Somewhere, and I had some excellent merit data that came across my desk after it sent a PowerPoint in this morning. Mm-hmm. So, or beyond here. But somewhere along the line, general education classes, the general education associate became eligible. Okay? So that's when it started appealing to some other kids. Now, when a freshman comes into our open house at first, you know, they come in to enroll, they're all going to go to Mizzou, they're going to go to Illinois, or WashU, or UCLA, they're pretty sure of it. So, on a full ride, football, baseball, and somewhere along the line, well, maybe that dream kind of falls by the wayside. But then they'll say, well, I'm going here, and then you show them this, and this is what it costs to go to Truman State. It was Northeast Missouri when I went there 30 years ago.
And it's about Missouri State College when I went
right
there.
I wasn't going to bring that up. But it's about eight times higher than it was when I attended there. So, and the minimum wage has only doubled since that time. So you can't work part-time jobs and pay for your school without giving some loans. And then this is the result. So when you start encompassing that, especially the parents can hear this, you start putting numbers about debt up. Now that gets their attention. So 2 years ago, the Department of Higher Ed took over running A-plus for the state. It wasn't DESE, and there was a lot of back and forth, and finally the Department of Higher Ed took over, and they changed some of the rules, and one of those rules is we don't have to update the partnership plans. We have the same partnership plans we had when Department of Higher Ed took it over. So we would have an advisory committee meeting twice a year, but when this change came, we were looking to cut, you know, our spending. So this is one of the things that happened. If it comes back in, we'll start doing it again. So our ongoing data that we reported on every year, this is our dropout rate from 14 to 16, and as you can see, our dropout rate has gone down. Okay, our graduation rate has also gone down on 4 year and 5 year. So that tells me they're not dropping out, but maybe the non-traditional students aren't completing in that time frame. Okay, so with Edmentum and courses like that, hopefully we're getting their high school equivalency. On our four-year universities, we have more students last year attending four-year universities than they did the year before. And for the first time since the recession, our community college numbers have dropped. And also our tech school numbers have dropped. However, our military numbers have increased, and the number of students that are going to work right out of high school have increased. So there's probably some offset there. So, and then finally, our school enrollment numbers. Now, these were the numbers as of Tuesday last week. I called Mrs. Wolf and asked her how many students she had, and I got on the district website and found enrollments. And so, we're above the 40% norm that was set by us by force about 6 years ago. So we've dropped a little bit in one at McClure, but we're in McClure North, but South is up. So best program in school is, I tell the kids, it's your educational insurance policy. And that doesn't really get their attention, but you know, if the parents are there, they'll sign them up, they'll say you're signing up. So my goal is to just sign the freshmen up. Anybody that comes to school, just make it part of the enrollment package, you're signing up, and then let the kids weed themselves out along the way. So, any questions?
Any motion to accept the A-plus school report?
I do.
Second.
Been moved by Ms. Hogshead, second by Dr. Graves. Any questions for Mr. Bowles?
That's a comment I want to make. And he said something about this, but and I said this earlier when we were talking about the community meeting we had at Cameron University. We had at Walnut Grove on Saturday. I'll just use one word. Debt. And I don't know if we are as aware of a growing epidemic around this country of college students graduating with mounds of debt. And when they graduate, they already are behind because they have a degree. If they can't get a job, they have loans that are due already. And you know, you just showed an example. Nicole, when she was putting together the handbook for the dual enrollment, dual credit. You know, she put an example in there, and we just used Mizzou, just because that's sort of, you know, the flagship school in the state. But you gave an example just a moment ago, Truman State, and the cost of tuition, $20,800. So multiply that times four, that's $80,000. And so that money has to be paid. Well, you get Pell Grant, you get other things that are part of your financial aid package, but it doesn't pay for it all. And if your parents can't afford it, like, you know, my grandmother couldn't, mom couldn't, so how do you pay for it? Well, you know, you get work study, but who wants to do that? I didn't. So you get what? A loan. And every year, students are having all of these loans for 4 years of school. So the example we put in there was if you get, and we're just talking about AP, IB sort of, you know, if they get these courses in high school, then it could account for maybe a year worth of college. A year worth of college tuition can equal close to $20,000. Well, you're talking about 2 years through A-plus schools, 2 years of two-year degree, and, you know, and it's 10 cents on the dollar, probably.
It's around $6,500 to $7,000 for 2 years worth of tuition.
Yeah.
But if you...
2 years, though.
But if you subtract 2 years of Mizzou at $25,000, you know, living there, taking classes, writing books, living life.
So my point is that not only do we have to keep saying this, but we have to make sure somehow or another to get our families to get this clear, especially when we have students who are first generation college, because they think this is a barrier. And if we don't advertise it or do something to get it out there more, then we're going to continue to have this as a problem. And so I just wanted to say that because this issue of debt is bigger than just our students. It transcends into the communities, into the neighborhoods, and it's a problem.
Any more comments? Other than I looked at that tuition and I got a scholarship to Truman State when I went there, and I got a full year scholarship, $180. $180 for a whole year, $90 a semester. Times have changed.
Yes.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Dr. Diggs, comprehensive. Oh, this is Dr. Davis had asked that we postpone this until next Wednesday. I need a motion to postpone calling.
So moved. To postpone until next Wednesday. I move that we postpone it until next Wednesday.
Second?
Second.
I move by Ms. Hogshead, second by Dr. Graves. All those in any discussion on postponing? All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Building leadership capacity. Dr. Land.
Good evening. So, Amy was here this evening to share this wonderful opportunity we had to
really develop a plan for transformational leadership in our district. So I'm going to share now the item is called Building Leadership Capacity. For the past several months, district leaders have met with leaders from the Santa Fe Center for Transformational School Leadership, the Washington University Institute for School Partnership, and the St. Louis Community Foundation to develop a project for the purpose of building leadership capacity in the district. We are pleased to report that our partnership has received initial funding from a visionary family at the St. Louis Community Foundation for $400,000 toward this effort. The funding will cover costs for a 7-day summer leadership institute at Washington University this summer, as well as ongoing work over the next 2 years. The project will encompass professional development for leaders across the district, as well as the development of curricular and instructional supports, and provide an opportunity for research to establish a model for other districts to follow across the country. Thank you.
I move we approve the building leadership capacity.
Second.
And moved by Ms. Hogshead and seconded by Mr. Ebert. Any questions or comments? This is what was presented earlier during the or comments. Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mark your calendars for June 1st through June 9th at Washington University.
And I will add, I always have a comment on. So June 1st through the 9th, I want asking all of our board to be there, and we're going to invite other elected officials around our community because this is, I think, monumental, and I really want to add the support of our elected officials to be a part of this as we build more partnerships, especially with Washington University and the Santa Fe Center. So please put that June 1st through the 9th on your calendars. In actuality, I want you to come any day, but in particular, on June 1st, when we begin, we'll have sort of an opening ceremony session kind of thing, you know, hour and a half. We'll have some, you know, refreshments and all, but we'd love to have you come on that day.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Aru, Ms. Salomon, Policy 101, Employment and Assignment Policy.
During the negotiations, this year, we brought to the board a policy that permitted LPNs to be accepted by the district. And we have discovered since then that there is another policy that is impacted. And under Policy 101, Employment and Assignment, we are asking the board to approve language. Actually, it's just to say a current LPN as far as the certification that's permitted. We need that so we can go ahead and hire those, or at least interview those that have LPN certification. It's just a separate place in policy. You've already approved it. We just need to bring that to your attention.
I move we amend to a current LPN.
Second.
Yeah, moved by Ms. Hogshead and seconded by Mr. Ebert. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Same sign? Negative or opposed, same sign? Motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any motion to adjourn?
Second.
Thank you. Moved by Mrs. Hogshead and seconded by Dr. Graves. No, it's not. What's that? Madam Secretary, can follow up.
Aye.
Mr. Brown?
Aye.
Dr. Green?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you all for coming tonight.